resurrection and the life, saith the Lord. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. And though this body be destroyed, yet shall I see God, whom I shall see for myself, and mine eyes shall behold, and not as a stranger. For none of us liveth to himself, and no man dieth to himself. For if we live, we live unto the Lord, and if we die unto the Lord. Whether we live, therefore, or die, we are the Lord's. Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. Even so saith the Spirit, for they rest from their labors. The Lord be with you.
And also with your spirit.
Let us pray. O God, whose mercies cannot be numbered, accept our prayers on behalf of thy servant Robert, and grant him an entrance into the land of light and joy, in the fellowship of thy saints, through Jesus Christ, thy Son, our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-matured wines, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-matured wines strained clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from all the earth. For the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, "Lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore we will not fear, even though the earth be removed and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though its waters roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with its swelling. There is a river whose stream shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacle of the Most High. God is in the midst of her, she shall not be moved. God shall help her just as the break of dawn. The nations raged, the kingdoms were moved. He uttered his voice, the earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us, the God of Jacob is our refuge. Come, behold the works of the Lord, who has made desolations in the earth. He makes way at wars cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and cuts the spear in two. He burns the chariot in the fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge.
A reading from the Revelation of John. After this I looked, and there was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, robed in white with palm branches in their hands.
And they cried out with a loud voice, saying, "Salvation belongs to our God who is seated on the throne and to the Lamb." And all the angels stood around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, singing, "Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, "Who are these, robed in white, and where have they come from?" And I said to him, "Sir, you are the one who knows." Then he said to me, "These are they who have come out of the great ordeal. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. For this reason, they are before the throne of God and worship him day and night within his temple. And the one who is seated on the throne will shelter them. They will hunger no more and thirst no more. The sun shall not strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of the water of life, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Forever. Hallelujah. I will dwell. The letter of remembrance that I read is written by Bishop Daniel of the Eastern Diocese of the Armenian Church of America. It is addressed to the Right Reverend Andrew Dicha, 16th Bishop of New York of the Episcopal Diocese of New York. Your Grace, please accept my warmest good wishes in this holy season of Eastertide. I greet you in the name of our risen Lord Jesus, with the hope-filled refrain of the Armenian Church, Christos Hariav Imerelots, Christ is raised from the dead. Earlier this month, the acting dean of General Theological Seminary, the Very Reverend Michael DeLashmet, did me the honor of inviting me to the Memorial Eucharist for the Reverend Canon Dr. J. Robert Wright of blessed memory. A dear friend, both to me personally and to the Armenian Church community in general. Regrettably, my duties as bishop will find me in Armenia on the date of the service. I have asked the dean of our St. Nersa Seminary, the Reverend Father Mardios Chevian, also a longtime associate and friend to Canon Wright, to attend in my stead and pay our solemn respects to the memory of our dear friend and colleague. With this letter, I would like to offer some personal reflections on the occasion. I was blessed to know Canon Wright for many years. I was in my early seminary days when I had occasion to hear him speak for the first time, and therefore I would eagerly await any opportunity to hear his learned discourses at ecumenical and academic gatherings. I had first met him personally during my years as Dean of St. Nersa's Seminary, and I recall vividly our many pleasant conversations. Canon Wright's wisdom and deep knowledge of the Eastern churches, especially of the Armenian Church, was highly valued by me, and it must be said by nearly every Armenian churchman and academic of standing in the English-speaking world. That certainly included my two predecessors as primates of the Eastern Diocese, Patriarch Torko Manugyan of Jerusalem of blessed memory, and Archbishop Khajag Barsamyan, as well as the many clergy who studied with him at GTS and who maintained their friendships over the subsequent years. Above all, Canon Wright struck me as a true servant of God. His erudition naturally led him onward to great academic achievements, but it was his warmth and humility of character that seemed to be the core of his being and the light that illuminated those around him, students, colleagues, fellow clergy, and faithful from every walk of life. His passing was obviously a great loss to GTS, the Episcopal Church in the U.S., and indeed the world. At this moment of such turbulence in our society, voices such as Canon Wright's, wise, humane, and pacific, are in great need. I pray that the countless people blessed to have known him, who will always be inspired by his example, will spread his divine gifts throughout our world. May our risen Lord remember his gentle, faithful servant on the great day of the coming of his kingdom. May the blessed memory of the righteous be blessed. With my prayers, Bishop Daniel.
I bring a letter from the presiding bishop of the Episcopal Church. It's addressed to the people gathered in remembrance of the Reverend J. Robert Wright, Chapel of the Good Shepherd, the General Theological Seminary, and dated May 19, 2022. For the repose of the soul of Reverend J. Robert Wright, dear friends in Christ, my prayers and the prayers of Episcopalians throughout the entire church are with you today as you mourn the passing and celebrate the life of J. Robert Wright. Father Wright was a blessing to the church and all who knew him, a revered scholar, an ecumenical leader, a valued teacher, and a passionate historian. A grateful and heartbroken church mourns with you. We offer prayers for the repose of his soul, and we offer prayers of healing for those gathered here today, for his whole family, and for all the people he so faithfully and diligently served in the name of the risen Christ, in whom Bob now has his rest. I give God thanks for his life and ministry among us. And the letter closes with a heartfelt benediction and is signed, your brother in Christ, the Most Reverend Michael B. Curry, presiding bishop and primate of the Episcopal Church.
In the name of our God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen. Amen. Bishop Deechee, Dean DeLashmet, honored guests. It is indeed a great honor to join you today in giving thanks for the life of our friend and teacher, J. Robert Wright. And there's no better place for us to gather than in this chapel, a spiritual home, a place of pilgrimage. As students, as faculty, as friends of this seminary, we know that the presence of the Lord is with us in this place. And many of us gathered here today have spent many hours sitting here, praying here, at daily chapel, on holy days, at special events. How well we know the way the sunlight, on most days, illuminates the stained glass, particularly over the door to the chapel, lifting us up in the beauty of holiness. The presence of this chapel on Chelsea Square, inside this close, where the noise and the clamor of the city fade away, this tells the world that this institution was founded and continues to form priests, and emphasizes the centrality of the liturgy always in the work of forming priests. That is the work that Father Wright did for more than 40 years as historian, as theologian, as bridge builder, as teacher. Father Wright used to tell me that attendance at daily chapel was his way of tracking how his students were doing. You may know that. If those who attended regularly suddenly stopped coming to chapel, or if those who seldom showed up were suddenly here twice a day praying mightily, he'd know it was time for a chat and find out what was going on in their lives. Right over there, where Professor Kevin Moroney is sitting today, is the faculty stall that J. Robert Wright occupied in worship for more than 40 years. And right above that, if you can see it, is, is carved the word ecclesia, church. Part of the carving of the Latin translation of the prayer for the consecration of a priest in the Book of Common Prayer that crosses around this chapel. Look around at it. And today we celebrate Canon Wright's crossing into eternity. We join to commend him to the deathless love and the transfiguring mercy of God, who through Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit draws us all, the living and the dead, into the vast fellowship of love and prayer we call the communion of saints. Bob Wright devoted himself to the words we've just heard in our reading, one flock, one shepherd, yes, one communion. And that communion of saints was not only the focus of Father Wright's life, his labor, his scholarship, it is his legacy, and it is his challenge to us right now, today, when we go forth from this place. The ecumenical movement that he championed, that we all may be one, is the justice and the peace movement for which our broken, war-torn, terrified nation and world yearns for right now. From the late 19th century, the U.S. Episcopal Church has been a significant leader of the ecumenical movement. In the second half of the 20th century, when Bob came of age as a scholar and as a teacher, can be seen as a golden age of progress towards the unity of the churches, with the formation of the World Council of Churches in 1948, made up of Anglican, Protestant, and Eastern Orthodox churches, and then the expansion of the movement with the entry of the Roman Catholic Church at the Second Vatican Council in the 1960s. The goal of this movement is full communion, a concrete visual realization of communion among people of faith through the full interchange of sacrament, baptism, Holy Communion, as well as the common sharing in of ordained ministers and priests across denominational boundaries. And it is to this goal that Bob dedicated himself. In this work, his primary role was as a behind-the-scenes advisor to presiding bishops and bishops of New York, theological consultant, and official representative of the Episcopal Church in negotiating full communion agreements and in navigating encounters with world Christian leaders, of which the Episcopal Church increasingly, in his lifetime, became a more active partner in the world community of Christian believers, extending ecumenism beyond our borders. 2008, the Archbishop of Canterbury, Rowan Williams, awarded Canon Wright the Cross of St. Augustine, honoring this role, above all, of behind-the-scenes advisor and guide to so many archbishops and bishops throughout our communion. Tobias Holler recalls seeing Father Wright at an event shortly after he received this cross. He was so proud, Tobias told me. He was like a little boy who had just received a prize toy, literally giddy. And he leaned over to me and whispered, smiling, ear to ear, "Tobias, you know, I slept with it on my pillow last night." And yet there was a side to this role that was not glamorous at all. Year after year, long weekends he spent in conference centers with bad food and tedious negotiations, hammering out agreements on the fine points of theology that might lead to full communion. There were great setbacks and disappointments along the way. Canon Wright was particularly interested in the official dialogues of the Episcopal Church with the Roman Catholic Church and the Eastern Orthodox Churches and the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America. However, when the ordination of women as priests and bishops was officially authorized by the Episcopal Church in 1976, a move Canon Wright first opposed and then in 1973 vigorously supported, and then when Presiding Bishop Frank Griswold consecrated the first openly gay bishop in the Episcopal Church in 2003, and the Episcopal Church authorized a liturgy for same-gender weddings, progress toward full communion with Roman Catholics and the Orthodox Churches slowed down decisively. And yet, Bob Wright's ambassadorial mission to these two churches, these two Christian bodies, never came to an end. His gift for friendship, his gift for hospitality, aimed at maintaining relations with these two great Christian bodies, did not fade. For example, he nurtured a deep personal friendship with Edward Cardinal Egan, the Archbishop of New York, from 2000 to 2009. Once, when Bob Wright broke his ankle with one call to Cardinal Egan, Father Wright was sent to Catholic Rehabilitation of New York City, and he was given the Cardinal's suite for his recovery, and he stayed 2 weeks. When Cardinal Egan hosted Pope Benedict XVI in New York in 2008, the Cardinal made it possible for the Pope to honor Father Wright with a papal pontifical medal. And he maintained equally close ties with the Orthodox through all these years. He helped restore the Serbian Orthodox Cathedral of St. Sava in Manhattan, just a few blocks away on 25th Street. After the service, go over and see it and how that restoration is still going on, which had been a former Episcopal church, a chapel of Trinity Church, but became an Orthodox cathedral, and after a fire in 2016, Bob worked so hard to raise the funds for its restoration to find donors. And on his frequent trips to the Holy Land to meet with Orthodox prelates, he became well known as a shrewd barterer for ancient coins and antique rugs in the Jerusalem marketplace. You're not surprised at that. Of all of Canon Wright's contributions to the ecumenical movement, none has been more significant than his path-breaking work in Anglican-Lutheran relations, the achievement of full communion between the Episcopal Church and the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America. Some of his colleagues on that great work are seated here today. He was the principal Episcopal architect and drafter of Call to Common Mission, 1999. Which allowed our two churches to officially declare full communion at the Washington Cathedral in January 2001. Theologian Michael Root has said that this full communion between our two churches would never have come to pass without the learning and the unflagging commitment of Bob Wright. And just to say that at this General Convention, we will have resolutions going to the convention to maintain and build full communion with Canadian Lutherans, Bavarian Lutherans, and the Church of Sweden. All of this work building on what was done in 1999 and after. It was here in the seminary, on this campus, that Bob found his community, his own communion of saints. Here he was J. Bob, he was Professor Xeroxes, and Bob the Walking Footnote. Some of you have used these names for him, sometimes behind his back, sometimes to his face. And some of the students from the class of 81, members of the basketball team that he coached for 44 years, some of them are in this chapel, they recall waiting in the gym one night for the coach to arrive. And in came Dr. Wright, they say, black suit, tab collar, carrying a sheaf of papers in his hand. And one student recalls, were these papers basketball plays? Were these papers our schedule of games with Virginia Seminary and other places? No, there were the notes to a scholarly lecture on the relationship between athaleo and askeo in the patristic writings, which right there in the gym, now it used to be down there under the refectory, he delivered this lecture to us while we were wearing our shorts and sneakers, and only at general, only with J. Robert Wright would something like this happen. I wish we had a film of it. Another former student, Lee Powers, recalls that he and Joel Ireland and Bill Kavanaugh visited Father Wright just before the pandemic set in, and they say, we brought him his favorite dinner, coconut shrimp from Red Lobster, but we forgot the dipping sauce. And he refused my several offers to go back and get the sauce, saying, that's not necessary. But with each bite, we could hear him say softly, this would be so much better with that sauce. Only Father Wright could make three priests with over 30 years ministry experience feel like this. I know that there are many more J-Bob stories, which we can hear later at the reception. But beyond his quirks and his eccentricities, which did exist, his hated cell phone, his beloved mass class, Teddy the Mop, there is this in the words of another student. He will be remembered because of the impact he had on the lives and the ministry of this student body. He will always be remembered as a mentor who helped form many for the service in the church and beyond. J. Robert Wright poured his life into his many and varied interests, but he also poured his life into his students. And I'm sure that every faculty advisor at GTS had a profound impact on their students, but I would argue that few had as much of an impact on this seminary and its formation, as did J. Robert Wright. Our closing hymn this morning is Ye Watchers and Ye Holy Ones. And I think there could be no better definition of the communion of saints to which we all belong as members of this seminary community, in our roles in the Episcopal Church and in the wider world, that ecumenical web of grace that binds us together in a communion of communities. His scholarship ties together the earliest church and the medieval period to teach the 21st century about balancing the autonomy of local religious communities with the coherence of what must be a universal church. And our membership in the Communion of Saints reminds us that we share in the fellowship and encouragement not just of the heroism of those of ancient times, the holy ones he taught us about of previous centuries and cultures, but also our contemporaries whose lives and who died for the faith and in the faith in our own time that is now so threatened. So how might the power of this communion of saints be used most effectively in the terrified world outside these doors, beyond this close, around the world? We witness a dangerous war in Europe. We witness the rise of a Christian nationalism and replacement theory fascism played out in the bloodshed at the Topps store in Buffalo on Saturday. A few nights ago, I met David Nirenberg, a Jewish medievalist and intellectual historian, who is the new director of the Institute for Advanced Studies in Princeton. And he asked me this pointed question: Bill, why aren't the great Protestant denominations, he meant us too, of course, why aren't you really fighting together rising US fascism today? Why indeed? The ecumenical movement for which Father Wright worked for so many years and which we treasure today has the potential to be a justice and peace movement the world desperately needs of the churches at this moment. Why are we ecumenical partners not using the power of our commitment to each other to push back vigorously right now against those who would weaponize faith, who would politicize faith, and would make narrow religious belief a loyalty test. Our own Margaret Rose, sitting over here, who will lead our prayers in a moment, the presiding bishop's deputy for ecumenism and interreligious work, recently was part of a panel at the National Workshop on Unity. And she listed some of the panel's observations about what is the definition of ecumenism right now. Number one, that as the last 3 years of pandemic, political division, and economic hardship have shown so clearly, we share now an ecumenism of suffering. Number two, we must listen to what divides us. The legacy of slavery, for example, is something that still divides us. And then exchange the gifts that enrich us all in unity. And number three, we must acknowledge that religion is no longer a private Sunday morning 11 o'clock activity. It is front page news every day, intertwined with Supreme Court decisions, with threats against those of other faiths, and religious autocracies at home and abroad. In my final conversations with J. Robert Wright, he shared with me these concerns. For J. Robert Wright was never bashful about affirming that his life was in service to his God, whatever the cost. He said, "I do everything for my Lord and Savior." Our opportunity today is to go out and follow his example. God has used God's people to accomplish great things in the past. And how will God use us if we will but respond to the divine initiative? Bishop Andy Doyle of Texas came close to Bob's thinking toward the end when he wrote these words on Facebook last Sunday. "Every tradition needs to stand to clearly denounce white supremacy and Nazism. What we see in Buffalo is part of a well-established neo-Nazi movement in our country. We cannot underestimate this movement. White supremacy is a global lie that perpetuates a false god, faux theodicy, and violence. What if every tradition would stand together as a communion, a united body? At this hour of urgency, may we be bound to the mission to which J. Robert Wright gave his life, that we all may be one. Amen."
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us pray to the Lord. Almighty God, who has knit together thine elect in one communion and fellowship, in the mystical body of thy Son, Christ our Lord, grant, we beseech thee, to thy whole church in paradise and on earth, thy light and thy peace.
Amen.
Grant that all who have been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection may die to sin and rise to newness of life, and that through the grave and gate of death, we may pass with him to our joyful resurrection.
Amen. Amen.
Grant to us who are still in our pilgrimage and who walk as yet by faith, that thy Holy Spirit may lead us in holiness and righteousness all our days.
Amen.
Amen.
Grant to thy faithful people pardon and peace, that we may be cleansed from all our sins and serve thee with a quiet mind.
Amen. Amen.
Grant to all who mourn a sure confidence in thy fatherly care, that casting all their grief on thee, they may know the consolation of thy love.
Amen.
Amen.
Give courage and faith to those who are bereaved, that they may have strength to meet the days ahead in the comfort of a reasonable and holy hope, in the joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love.
Amen.
Amen.
Help us, we pray, in the midst of things we cannot understand, to believe and trust in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to life everlasting.
Amen. Amen.
Grant us grace to entrust Robert to thy never-failing love. Receive him into the arms of thy mercy, and remember him according to the favor which thou bearest unto thy people.
Amen.
Amen.
Grant that, increasing in knowledge and love of thee, he may go from strength to strength in the life of perfect service in thy heavenly kingdom.
Amen.
Amen.
Grant us, with all who have died in the hope of the resurrection, to have our consummation and bliss in thy eternal and everlasting glory, and with all thy saints, to receive the crown of life which thou dost promise to all who share in the victory of thy Son, Jesus Christ, who liveth and reigneth with thee and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Dear friends in Christ, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you. Some of my closest friends in the ministry and in my life studied at this seminary under Father Wright. with a very deep well of Christian wisdom that you shared with the students and with the church, and everyone is blessed by that. Bill Morgan died in January, just weeks after Robert died. And subsequently, David Beers has died. And this passing of these three enormous figures in the Episcopal Church has called me back to that wonderful line in Scripture. There were giants in the earth in those days. At Bill Morgan's funeral, one of our priests who had been calling on him in his infirmity to the end of his life told me, "I think that when Bill learned Bob had died, he made the decision that it was time for him to go as well." And I think that certainly it raises for me that thing that comes to us when we see those who taught us, who came before us, who led us, who walked with us and showed us the way. When we see them pass out of our midst, it raises the question, how can we continue in this journey without them? And I think that that is what I've heard in different words from people who knew and loved Bob in these months now since he passed. How can we be the Episcopal Church if Bob is not in it? He was that big a figure for us. And for this seminary, he was monumental. The ecumenical movement, with the participation and leadership of Bill Morgan and of Robert Wright, though not finished, with work left to do, with a slowing of some of those conversations, has changed the church that we were born into. For those of us old enough, born into the Episcopal Church before that movement, how Protestants and Catholics looked at each other has changed utterly. And for people like Bill and Bob and others who went to the deep places in those conversations and dug in and help to bring that transformation in our common life. No matter that most of the people in church don't know their names, everyone's life has been increased by the work that they did in their living. And today we may say that there is a great crowd of witnesses who are not watching this online and are not here and don't know who J. Bob Wright is, but enjoy communion and fellowship with those of other faiths with a clarity and a brilliance which they enjoy because of Robert Wright and what he did with the years he was given. So it's a privilege for us to be here today to commend him to God, for this seminary to bid him farewell, and to give thanks to God for 2.5 generations of priests who passed through here and went out into the church and have been taking those things that they learned from Bob, those things drawn out of Bob's deep, deep well of experience and wisdom, and have scattered over all these years in their congregations to give thanks for them and for what Bob meant for their life, their living, and their proclamation of the gospel. Walk in love, as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto our Lord God.
It is meet and right, so to do.
It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who rose victorious from the dead, and doth comfort us with the blessed hope of everlasting life. For to thy faithful people, O Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when our mortal body doth lie in death, there is prepared for us a dwelling place eternal in the heavens. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying, All glory be to thee, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, for that thou of thy tender mercy didst give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made there by his one oblation of himself once offered a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and did institute, and in his holy gospel command us to continue a perpetual memory of that his precious death and sacrifice until his coming again. For in the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many, for the remission of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it, in remembrance of me." Wherefore, O Lord and Heavenly Father, according to the institution of thy dearly beloved Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, we, thy humble servants, do celebrate and make here before thy divine majesty, with these thy holy gifts which we now offer unto thee, the memorial thy Son hath commanded us to make, having in remembrance his blessed passion and precious death, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, rendering unto thee most hearty thanks for the innumerable benefits procured unto us by the same. And we most humbly beseech thee, O merciful Father, to hear us, and of thy almighty goodness, vouchsafe to bless and sanctify with thy word and Holy Spirit these thy gifts and creatures of bread and wine, that we, receiving them according to thy Son, our Savior Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. And we earnestly desire thy fatherly goodness, mercifully to accept this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, most humbly beseeching thee to grant that by the merits and death of thy Son, Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and all thy whole church may obtain remission of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice unto thee, humbly beseeching thee that we and all others who shall be partakers of this holy communion may worthily receive the most precious body and blood of thy Son, Jesus Christ, be filled with thy grace and heavenly benediction, and made one body with him, that he may dwell in us, and we in him. And although we are unworthy, through our manifold sin, to offer unto thee any sacrifice, yet we beseech thee to accept this, our bounden duty and service, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom, in the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end. Amen. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ hath taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We do not presume to come to this thy table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in thy manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under thy table, but thou art the same Lord whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of thy dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith.
with thanksgiving. Preserve thy body and soul unto everlasting life.
Thank you.
Friends, let us pray. Almighty God, we thank thee that in thy great love thou hast fed us with the spiritual food and drink of the body and blood of thy Son, Jesus Christ, and hast given unto us a foretaste of thy heavenly banquet. Grant that this sacrament may be unto us a comfort in affliction and a pledge of our inheritance in that kingdom where there is no death, neither sorrow nor crying, but the fullness of joy with all thy saints, through Jesus Christ our Savior. The God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen.